Hello everybody, my name is Andreas Fabri and I work at Geometry Factory. This will be a rather compact, non-technical and non-scientific presentation. The goal is to give you an idea what is Seagull, the software as well as a project, and in which way you can contribute. If you were ever wondering about the Seagull logo and its color, it was proposed by Remco Feldkamp here at Utrecht University. That was back in 96 and we wrote as mission statement in the Seagull project proposal to make the large body of geometric algorithms developed in the field of computational geometry available for industrial applications. This is still true, but the scope has gotten much larger. In the Seagull library, you find implementations of algorithms presented at SIGGRAPH, at SGP, at IMR, at SMI, to name but a few. Let's have a look at the large body of algorithms. In 2D, you find triangulations algorithms. With the Delaunay triangulation, you automatically have, as dual, the Voronoi diagram of points. Seagull also has Voronoi diagrams of segments and disks. In the second row, you can see several algorithms that operate on polylines and polygons. The polyline simplification has the property that it maintains the topology while simplifying. The Boolean operations can operate on polygons consisting of linear and circular arcs. You also find algorithms for computing visibility from a point inside a polygon, algorithms for computing offsets, algorithms for computing the straight skeleton. Let's take a closer look at the various triangulations, as they are rather versatile tools. The Delaunay triangulations have the empty circumcircle property. Regular triangulations deal with weighted points drawn as red circles here. What the weights do is best seen in the dual, also called power diagram. The circle pushes the Voronoi edge, here depicted in blue, away. Delaunay and regular triangulation exist for 2D and 3D and higher dimensions. Constraint triangulations respect input segments, here drawn in red. This is used to triangulate polygonal domains and needed for Delaunay meshing in 2D. We do not yet have 3D constraint triangulations in Seagull. Periodic triangulations live in a unit domain, and triangles on the border, like this one, they wrap around. So this triangle is identical to this one, it only is there once. For periodic triangulations, we have users in astrophysics, and we are aware of plenty of publications in material science. Hyperbolic triangulations live in the hyperbolic plane, here represented as Poincaré disk. A line is an arc of a circle orthogonal to the disk. So this here is a line, straight line. The next couple of slides are in 3D about point set processing, polygon mesh processing, and mesh generation. Point set processing, you find elements of a surface reconstruction pipeline, removing outliers, doing smoothing of the point set, estimating normals, Poisson surface reconstruction, and other reconstruction algorithms. You have algorithms for upsampling, so you want to have a denser point cloud. You have algorithms for shape detection, which identify points which sit on the same face because they are coplanar, or which sit on a spherical patch. Then you find, that's pretty recently, registration algorithms. It's not properly in Seagull, but we collaborate with the OpenGR project. Let me go through some polygon mesh processing algorithms as they are somehow at the core of SGP. Co-refinement, that's the simultaneous subdivision of intersecting faces. So here we have green mesh and blue mesh. And we want the two meshes make conform so that they the initial faces get split and the edges of the green and the blue are one, they conform. That's the basis for Boolean operations. Then we have algorithms like skeletonization, so based on the mean curvature flow, kind of a shrinking of the surface. Edge collapse based mesh simplification, so Turk-Lindstrom. Hole filling algorithms, where we also do fairing so that you have smooth transitions at the boundary. We have for distances on the surface, so geodesic distances, we have one package which computes the shortest geodesic path. So the path goes through the interior of faces. So you see that on the left. And we have approximate geodesic distances. So based on the heat method, Keen and Crane. Algorithms for segmentation based on the distance to the skeleton. Algorithms for deforming meshes. So as rigid as possible deformation with Olga Zorkin. And then also topological algorithms for doing homotopy tests. On the Seagull website, you can find 2 30-minute YouTube videos about polygon mesh processing. The technology, well, the algorithms behind the one presentation and covering the API on the other one. Sébastien Leriot made them for the Seagull workshop at SBM SMI 2020. It was in June, so just last month. The algorithms you have seen so far, they have a template parameter for the mesh type. We follow the design of the Boost graph library and extended its hierarchy of graph classes by adding the notion of faces. So we introduced the concept of a face graph. This enables to use the Seagull algorithms with libraries such as OpenMesh, the PMP library, also presented in this graduate school, and obviously with 2 half-edge data structures in Seagull, Polyhedron, and Surface Mesh. Going to mesh generation. So most mesh generation algorithms of Seagull are based on Delaunay refinement. The basic idea is to probe the input starting with a rough approximation and to improve the mesh incrementally. The input may be an implicit function such as the Poisson function for point set surfaces and doing point set reconstruction right this way. It may be triangle meshes that describe the boundary of a volume, and so we want to remesh them. It might be isosurfaces in gray level images that we want to extract. It may be trimmed knobs patches. So that's work in progress together with INREA. We also recently added an isotropic remeshing algorithm for volumetric meshes by Tammy Bubeker's group at Telecom Paris. The best illustration for this algorithm is the histogram of the dihedral angles before and after the algorithm. So you see that the very small angles and the very big angles, they disappear. Again, you can find a video on mesh generation, again, about 30 minutes, which Sébastien prepared for SBM SMI 2020. So which gives much more detail about how do these Delaunay refinement algorithms work, how do they guarantee that sharp features are maintained. So there are some pretty technical things to discover. I've put 3 low-level tools together that we use all over the place in Seagull, and so they merit being mentioned separately. The AABB tree, access line bounding box tree, enables you to do ray shooting. It allows you to determine all faces that intersect a query plane. It allows to find the closest triangle to a point in XYZ, to name but a few applications. And the second one, it's not a data structure, but just an algorithm. So it's an algorithm that takes 1 or 2 sets of axis-aligned arbitrary dimensional bounding boxes. And it applies a user-provided callback on all pairs of boxes that overlap. For example, if the boxes are bounding boxes of faces of a triangle mesh, you can test easily for self-intersections. Spatial searching here on the right. I've depicted only in 2D, but it's arbitrary dimension again. So it enables to find k nearest neighbors in a higher dimensional point cloud, as well to perform range queries. So which are the points which lie in a query rectangle or in a query sphere? So it's basically a KD tree. Seagull in some numbers. Let's zoom out a little bit. We have a large code base. Many downloads. The software is well documented, and it seems that developers like it on GitHub. I do not really know what the stars on GitHub mean. The user community, so that's maybe a number that shows how many users do we have. So that's certainly an upper bound. The many manual pages shouldn't frighten you, because SQL can be broken down in many, many software components. There are about 20 active developers, and we have a major release every 6 months. And finally, we distribute SQL under 2 licenses. So SQL is software, obviously. So SQL is a C++ library. And when we started the project, Java came up, and we investigated if we should go for it. Luckily, we didn't. SQL is a C++ template class library. And when you don't like templates, SQL is definitely not made for you. SQL is a header-only library. It's somehow only half true. So some SQL packages have dependencies which are not header-only. We support all major platforms and all major compilers. For compilers, at least the latest 3 versions. We support all various C++ standards. That's a little bit tricky, and the question of finding a balance. We cannot jump on the latest features, because that would mean that all our users would have to follow. On the other hand, we cannot stick to language features that got deprecated and removed by the latest C++ standard. How to obtain standard SQL? Okay, we make releases available as Tarball. It can be installed with package managers and Fedora, Debian, Brew, VC package, and you can clone it from GitHub. Third-party libraries. Just as we try to convince you to leverage on SQL, the SQL project leverages on other highly specialized libraries. Boost is needed everywhere. When a Boost subraw library makes it into the C++ standard, we switch to the latter. GMP and MPFR are arbitrary precision number types, and they are used to make SQL robust. With robust, we mean dealing with problems related to floating point arithmetic. Then there are dependencies only for certain packages. So Eigen provides solvers for managed packages. Ceres provides a nonlinear solver used by a smoothing algorithm. Neural networks of TensorFlow and the random forests of OpenCV get used by point cloud classification. For the last 4 libraries in the list, we just provide wrappers for convenience. Lastlib for I/O of point clouds. So the point clouds together with classification information, then Metis for graph partition, and OpenGR and Point Matcher for point cloud registration. As I said in the beginning, the project started in 1996 with 7 research groups. In a whole series of European funded projects, new SQL packages figured as deliverables. Today, we have fewer academic partners with a long-term commitment, but globally more research groups which contribute. The Wikipedia defines project as a planned undertaking. The SQL project has published rules, defined roles for people and workflows. We have an editorial board, which, quite similar to the editors of a scientific journal, reviews submissions of new packages and accompanies the integration into the library. More about the submission process and our development infrastructure later. Let me speak a little bit about Geometry Factory, which emanated in 2003 from the SQL project. Don't be afraid. It's not a sales pitch, and I do not consider you as a potential customer. The goal is more to show you that there's a real demand for off-the-shelf geometric algorithms in industry. We are 7 R&D engineers with a PhD in computer science. We have a postdoc in collaboration with INRIA, and we will have a PhD student with INRIA starting in September. Our revenue comes from license sales of SQL software components and from services to customers. We offer the first line support for open source users as well as for commercial users. We have tight collaborations with our academic partners, and we are actively involved in the SQL project. We are represented in the editorial board, and we take care of the release management. We also develop SQL components starting from scientific publications as well as from prototype code made by authors. So a recent example for the latter is this SMI publication by Tami Bubeker's group. Seagull version is available in the latest beta release and the master branch on GitHub. Seagull is distributed under a dual license scheme, that is, the very same software is at the same time available under an open source license and under a commercial license. As open source license in the Seagull project, we have opted for the GPL and not a BSD style license on purpose. The GPL roughly says that users of Seagull who distribute binaries must distribute the source code of their own software under the GPL. The commercial product is not the library as a whole, but the different components, that is, the different algorithms and data structures. The different components have different academic owners, and Geometry Factory can obviously only offer a commercial license of the components because the academic owners granted us a commercialization license, and they get royalties from us. The primary goal of license revenue is to pay engineers for the maintenance of Seagull instead of putting the burden of maintenance on researchers. Without Geometry Factory, quite some Seagull packages would today be unmaintained as the initial developers left academia or changed their research topic. It's amazing to see the diversity of academic users on the project using Seagull page on the Seagull website. It's matched by the diversity of the commercial users. Unfortunately, only a few customers allow us to mention the name. Also, geographically, we can say geometric computing is ubiquitous. As for the distribution of commercial users, it's 1/3 in North America, 1/3 in Europe, 1/3 in Asia, Oceania, South America. So what I say here is probably the same for any geometry project. Let me come to the second part of this presentation where you will see how you can get involved. Most Seagull packages were developed by academic researchers. They are listed as package authors. And we provide BibTeX entries for each chapter in the package overview on the Seagull website. When you use Seagull in your research, please cite the packages you use in your publication. We list projects using Seagull on the Seagull website. I mentioned that earlier. In case you are a user and want to be listed here, let us know so that we can add a link. Why this page? When applying for internal or public funding for a research project with a Seagull component as deliverable, the list of users shows that Seagull is helpful to others. On the support page of the Seagull website, you can find a link to a feedback form. We don't ask who you are, but it helps us to prioritize knowing what of Seagull you use, in which application domain you work, and how you use it. Bug reports and questions, very valuable contributions. Only if we learn about a bug, we get a chance to fix it. What we need from you is a short, self-contained, compilable example. File a GitHub issue, upload code and data that crashes or produces a wrong result, and please give us enough context so that we can reproduce your problem. Do not hesitate to ask questions. Maybe something is not well explained. Maybe an example would help. Your questions help us to improve. We offer several communication channels, the aforementioned issue tracker, Stack Overflow, or just a post on the Seagull Discuss mailing list. The first two are sometimes the better choice, as it's easier to add a screenshot on illustration. As I said earlier, we consider bug reports and feedback as valuable contributions. There are many more ways you can contribute, so let's go through the following list to give you some ideas. A contribution can be a small addition to an existing package. It can be a completely new package. In the latter case, the starting point is often some prototype which you have developed to validate a publication. Or it can be some data structure developed in your master project where you think that it's of general interest. The Seagull project participates as mentoring organization in the Google Summer of Code. Google sponsors internships where the topics are proposed by mentoring organizations. In the past, we had internship topics where the student turned the prototype of a researcher into a Seagull package. For example, Keenan Crane, professor at CMU, who mentored together with me, a student who worked on the Seagull version of Keenan's heat method. Submissions of packages get reviewed. Sometimes we ask researchers not involved in Seagull development to make an external review, simply because they aren't the expert in the field. Yet another way to contribute is working with us to make software you prefer distributing independently interoperable with Seagull. As an example, we worked with Nicolas Melado, researcher at IRID in Toulouse, to enable a smooth interaction with the OpenGR point cloud registration library. This also involved a Google Sum of Code student. When you decide to contribute software to the Seagull project, you stay the owner of your code. The Seagull triangulations are owned by INRIA, the 2D Boolean operations are owned by Tel Aviv University, and so on. When you contribute, you do not give anything away, but you get a lot. You get recognition as you figure as package author, with a BibTeX entry, and potential users have a higher chance to find your code simply because Seagull is a well-established project. When you contribute, you are not on your own, but you profit from a well-defined workflow, shared project infrastructure, peer reviews, mutualized maintenance effort, interaction with the developer community. I mentioned earlier that submissions of new packages get reviewed. The Seagull editorial board plays a role similar to the editors of a journal. Before making a formal submission, you should contact us. Tell us what your contribution is about and what is your starting point. The editorial board has to see if there's a fit. It happened in the past that we recommended to contribute to some other library simply because it was a better fit. What you submit is the user and reference manual of your package. Contributors are in general Seagull users first, so they somehow know what we expect contributions to look like. Submission gets reviewed by a Seagull editorial board member and often by a second reviewer who is not necessarily a Seagull developer, but an expert in the field of your submission. It takes typically several rounds of reviewing, and once the API is fixed, contributors spend some time to change existing code. Submission must come with examples and a reasonable number of test cases. Once a contribution has matured, it may become a GitHub pull request and may become candidate for integration into the Seagull test suite. The Seagull test suite, it's public, it's a central piece of our shared infrastructure. The Seagull project does not provide binaries for three operating systems, but a source code library. The users of Seagull have different versions of C++, different versions of compilers, different versions of third-party libraries such as Boost, different versions of tools such as CMake. Additionally, to continuous integration using Travis and triggered by each push to the Seagull repository, we run a nightly test suite in the integration branch, that is the master branch plus candidates, and a weekly test suite for the master branch as well as for bug fix branches of three previous releases. Scrolling down on the test suite page, you see that we test about 30 different platforms. This also includes preview versions of compilers, as well as the master branch of third-party libraries, such as Boost or Eigen, in order to anticipate problems. Below the list of platforms, you can see a table with a row for each Seagull package and a column for each platform. Green means that compilation and execution passed without any problem. Yellow means warnings. Red means compilation or runtime errors. Blue means not applicable. Clicking on a letter, we can see the output of the run in order to debug. As I mentioned earlier, Seagull is on GitHub. We have several repositories, namely for the public branches, for the website, for the Swig bindings, and so on. Let us look at the repository named Seagull. In the code tab, you see one directory per package. So that's what we see here. On the right, you see the clone or download button. Most users download the latest Seagull release as tarball or install Seagull with a package manager. As a contributor for the full spectrum ranging from fixing a typo to a full-fledged new package, you should fork from here to your personal GitHub account, clone Seagull on your local machine, push changes to your fork and make pull requests so that your contribution gets reviewed, tested, integrated. Time is up. Thank you for your attention. We are looking forward to hearing from you. And if it was only because you always wanted to know why we have a giraffe on our Seagraph booth.